Thank you, Bruce. Good morning, all. As you can tell, I'm present in the church, so it might be a little echoey, and we'll figure that out in the Sundays to come, but I just really wanted to get back into the sacred space to broadcast Zoom worship service. So this morning, we're thankful that Kim Billings and Jen Murray will be reading the role of the people, and that Brett Corbett is our first reader. So we are using our Book of Common Prayer for our morning prayer service this morning. So if you have a prayer book nearby, you can follow along with the service. It begins on page 78. I was glad when they said to me, "Come, let us go to the house of the Lord." The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Our confession of sin. Let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, in the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Turning to page 80. Lord, open our lips.
And our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Our collect of the day, let us pray. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name, increase in us true religion, nourish us with all goodness, and bring forth in us the fruit of good works, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. The earth is the Lord's, for he made it. Come, let us adore him.
Psalm 95, page 82. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth. In the height of the hills are also his. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice.
The earth is the Lord's, for he made it. Come, let us adore him.
Psalm 105 can be found on page 739 in the Book of Common Prayer. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples.
Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works.
Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Search for the Lord in his strength. Continually seek his face.
Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth.
O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen.
Israel came into Egypt, and Jacob became a sojourner in the land of Ham.
The Lord made his people exceedingly fruitful. He made them stronger than their enemies.
Whose heart he turned so that they hated his people and dealt unjustly with his servants.
He sent Moses, his servant, and Aaron, whom he had chosen.
Alleluia.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The first reading is from Romans. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good.
Thank you.
This morning's gospel comes from Matthew. Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If you want to become my followers, deny yourselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? And what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." Here ends the gospel lesson. Please be seated. You're already seated. It's a habit. So for those of us who are list makers, who write down what we need to do during a day, or have the practice of cutting out interesting articles to save for later, the words of today's epistle are too good not to highlight this morning. In this letter, written some 30 years after the death and resurrection of Christ, Paul is at his most persuasive about the power of God to touch all of our lives and to shape us and direct us into new ways of being and believing. That is essentially and hopefully why you and I tune into Zoom worship, or in normal times, gather in a sacred space as community. Or this is why we spend time in quiet or in prayer or read scripture, even when we don't know how to begin. For you and I are sojourners. We are seekers. So we look at Paul, who is hypercharged with zeal after his conversion from being a Christian hater to a Christ follower and believer. He is laying out an argument about how, if we have faith, God can transform our hearts and the entire creation. We are changed not by trying to follow the letter of laws and commandments, but by the spirit and grace behind them. This is a bold letter, a systematic way to understand and live out the gospel. Many Christians have been born and formed by the words contained in these 16 chapters. Augustine, before he was a saint, found in Romans the source of his faith in Christ. In the year 1513, a monk named Martin Luther became truly born again through reading Romans by discovering it was only through grace and mercy that we have faith, not by any action or work that we can do to negotiate what God can only give freely. By the time we arrive at chapter 12, the reader has heard Paul's argument about why to believe in God through Jesus Christ. Paul takes us from Adam to Abraham to Moses to Jesus with a message that is for all and everyone. And those are the operable words for today, all and everyone. This is one of the reasons that the Christian faith took hold and grew so quickly 2,000 years ago in that part of the world where there were many shrines and many gods, but they were local shrines and local gods. It was a faith that extended beyond race and status and gender and family and tribe, all and everyone. Now, once we accept this good news, the question forward becomes, so how are we to live as a Christian? We move from right belief to right action. We know that one can believe in the creeds and read and quote the Bible, but faith needs to be put into practice. We all probably have our own notion of how a Christian should act and believe. I think we should always leave room for our own fragility, the fact that we all make mistakes, for our own weaknesses, but we still have the teachings of the Sermon on the Mount. We have the golden rule. We have that core command, Jesus, to love God and to love our neighbors. Those give us a pretty good roadmap of how to live. And if we ever stray or forget, well, Paul creates a handy list that we can copy down, cut out, print out, and tape it on our refrigerators next to those old photos and classroom art projects. We find chapter 12. Love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. These verses should be clear. God knows, and Paul knew, that we live in a finite world. It is the only world we have to live in and to care for. Our response is to trust in God and believe in infinite hope. May we rejoice in hope always. We have nothing else to ground our faith but for infinite hope. In Romans 12, verse 2, Paul writes that we are not to be conformed by this world, but transformed, changed, so that we might discern the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So do not be conformed, but be transformed. We are constantly challenged in not accepting the ways of the world, the way things have to be. So if you're like me, when our plates get full and the mood around us gets pretty grim, I think it might be natural to just want to throw up our hands and to say, you know what, there is little we can do, for nothing ever seems to change. Why hope for something different or more? Why care? Why forgive again? Why reach out? Why turn the other cheek? Why show respect if little respect is given in return? Why trust someone yet again when you've been disappointed? Many people are angry. And the thinking goes that we should meet their anger. We see this online. When people rage and fume, the common reaction of far too many is to rage in return. An eye for an eye still gets played out when we conform to this world, and it leads to nowhere good. Our path is transformation and change and new life. Paul writes, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Once we accept what God wants to give, we can offer the world, others, and ourselves a life that is more whole, more just, and more peaceful, a life closer to what God dreams for all of us. Sometimes I think Paul would like our roadside stands here in New Hampshire during the summer months. They are full of good things from the earth, fresh tomatoes. The tomatoes, we live for summer tomatoes in my household. They've been spectacular, corn and squash and peppers. And so when we stop by these stands, we are left to measure and count and then deposit the proper amount of money into that rusty old money box, and we can even make change. No one is looking, but we know what we are to do. You and I are being invited to know and to live out real love, not fake love, not transactional or temporary love, not say one thing and do another thing love. In his great sermon on love in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, read at most weddings we all attend because the words are so eternally right, we hear again that love is patient and kind, not envious, boastful, arrogant, or rude, or resentful. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And as if a period at the end of the sentence, love never ends. This description of love has consequences of how we live. So we know that the cross seen over my shoulder here at church is the universal symbol of the Christian faith. We look at the two beams of the cross, one vertical and one horizontal. They are visual tools to remind us of how our love of God, let's call it the vertical up and down, must connect at the center, must intersect and move across to the edges of the other beam in our love for one another. It cannot be one or the other. It has to be both. We hear in today's gospel, Jesus was beginning to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer. But he says, genuine love is always being tested. We know that genuine love is always tested in moments of conflict and fear and anger, and there is always tension between light and darkness. Hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. We are to hate what is evil, name it, resist it, call it out. The garden variety kind of evil and the Holocaust history bending kind. Many of us might describe the year 2020 as living through the movie Groundhog Day, that 1993 gem starring Bill Murray, who plays a television weatherman. The character Phil seems destined to relive February 2nd over and over again. I hear this in people's voices when I ask them how they are doing. Before it would be usually, I'm good, or I'm busy. Now the likely response is, well, pretty much the same. Groundhog Day, pretty much the same. But in the streets of our own country, there is a darkness in events that continue. They continue to get played out again and again. And if any of us are trying to live out the words of Romans chapter 12, we cannot look away or ignore or excuse or defend or explain away what is going on. This summer began when we learned the name George Floyd. And this summer is winding down when we learn another name, Jacob Blake. Groundhog Day, but not in a good way. Another African-American male shot by police. So we know that investigations will begin, as they should, and there will be vigils and marches and protests. When we talk about what is going on in the context of the gospel, are we venturing too far into politics? I ask you, and I cannot see your responses because I'm staring into a little green light on Zoom. I can't see if you are responsive to these comments or a little uncomfortable or squirming. I don't have the benefit of your comments in the back of the church. Is it stirring the pot when again and again we mention these scenes, or is it not enough? But we're trying, I'm trying to connect what Paul is teaching to what we are seeing. If we are to weep with those who weep, we need to be open with what is going on, even if it seems far away from us. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Believers in Jesus have much at stake in what we are watching. It lived out. Rinse and repeat. Centuries of slavery, segregation, discrimination, and violence have given us embedded systemic racism that is now being named more widely and called out. We are to hate what is evil. I was taken by what LA Clippers coach Doc Rivers said this past week in his remarks after the shooting of Jacob Blake that caused a walkout of the NBA. And I listened to Doc Rivers' calm and animating rage when he said, "We're the ones getting killed. We're the ones getting shot. We're the ones that have been denied to live in certain communities. We've been hung. We've been shot. And all you do is keep hearing about fear." And then it was this that he said that really got me. Rivers continued, It's amazing to me why we keep loving this country and this country does not love us back. And that comment hit me. It was a gut punch. The gospel Paul proclaimed in Romans about liberating and saving message is one meant for all and everyone. And it should make it harder for us in these times of conflict and controversy to return to our corners of tribe and family without anything else to say or do. When love is genuine, when it gets lived out, it's lived out in our homes and on the streets of our communities for all and everyone. We hear, "If it is possible, so far it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Extend hospitality to strangers." So I invite you to use these words, cut them out, print them out, use the verses as a prayer. They teach and remind us how Christians can live. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We turn now, because it is the morning prayer service, to the Apostles' Creed, found on page 96 in the Book of Common Prayer.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. God of love, we pray for your church, for Michael, our presiding bishop, Rob, our bishop, for all lay and ordained ministers, for all who seek you in the community of the faithful, equip us with the compassion and love to carry out your work of reconciliation in the world. God of love, hear our prayers for the church. God of freedom, we pray for our nation and all the nations of the world, for peace and unity across barriers of language, color, and creed, for elected and appointed leaders, that they would serve the common good, inspire all people with courage to speak out against hatred, and unite the human family in bonds of love. God of freedom, hear our prayers for the world. God of justice, we pray for the earth, your creation which you entrusted to our care. Move us to protect the earth and all its resources, that we may leave the legacy of beauty and abundance that you have given us. God of justice, hear our prayers for the earth. God of peace, we pray for this community, for our local leaders in our neighborhoods and workplaces. Kindle in every heart a desire for equality, respect, and opportunity for all. Help us to be instruments of peace, beginning here at home. God of peace, hear our prayers for this community. God of mercy, we pray for all in any need or trouble, for those whose lives are closely linked with ours and the whole human family, for refugees and prisoners, for the sick and suffering, the lonely and despairing, for those facing violence, for all held down by prejudice or injustice. Awaken in us compassion and humility as we seek and serve Christ in all persons. God of mercy, hear our prayers for all who are in need. God of grace, we pray for those who have died, for the faithful in every generation who have worked for justice, for prophets who called us to racial reconciliation, for martyrs who died because of hatred, and for all the communion of saints. Inspire us to proclaim your good news by word and example, and bring us at last into the glorious company of the saints in light. God of grace, hear our prayers for those who have died. We remember Cecile Soros, mother of Paul Soros, and Adele Huevas, former music director here at Christ Church.
And using the chat function in the Zoom format, we invite now your prayers and intercessions for those for whom you have been praying. We have been praying through an extensive list using this opportunity. So now we offer our prayers for Maureen and Lee. Pray for Dennis, for Steve, for Karen Foote, for Donna Lee, we pray. We pray for Melanie and Trina and Lionel. We pray for Judy and Carol. Pray for Deb and Tom McDonald. Pray for Tina and Kathy, for Priscilla. Continued prayers for Julian and Gage, for Kathy and Gail. Pray for all schools, students, teachers, administrators, as these days are beginning of online and in-person learning. Pray for parents. Pray for Tom, for Maddie and Irene and Edward, for Tom and Alex and Pat, for Jerry and Martha, for Joey G, and added extra prayer for school boards, those making weighty decisions, town councils, all of those. Summing up our prayers now, we pray the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. As we turn now, just for a brief set of announcements, and again, welcome. We have made this such a routine now that it seems this is what we do. Why do we do Zoom worship? Because we've always done it this way. That's the Episcopal motto. But it's good being here. I wish you were all here in the space with me, of course. Just a brief word about an email that most of you should be receiving this week. We will be inviting each of you to join our online community through Faith Life. This will be an opportunity for all of us to connect in a more meaningful way. It's a rich resource. So when you get this email, it's not a scam. It'll come with the Faith Life logo. And all you need to do is to go to their website and open up an account. You pick the password, and this will be a great way to stay connected. But we'll be reminding you, but know that it is coming as well. As well, Sally Farrell and I, we have been making plans for a kickoff Sunday on September 13th. Yes, we are going to have a kickoff Sunday. We will be here sharing resources for households and learning. We'll be having hot dogs on the go for you to run through and pick up on your way through the day. So we're going to try to start this year as if it were any year. So we're going to give this a try. So more news to follow about September 13th. As there is no musical offertory today, we now turn to our people to offer our closing Thanksgiving prayer.
Turn to page 102 in the Book of Common Prayer. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen.
Our closing hymn, I sing the almighty power of God. Thank you. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen. Here ends our service this morning. Thank you so much, Jen and Kim and Barbara and all of you for joining us. For those of you who are going to pop off the Zoom worship, we wish you a blessed day. We're going to hang out a little bit and stay on for some coffee hour. So I'm going to stop our YouTube link and I'm going to stop our recording, and it'll just be us.